I just want to serve you.
Amen.
And when you look at it from that perspective, you know, God really uses us in a tremendous way. God put this on my heart a while ago, and I want to share this with you this morning just to really encourage you. You have an awesome man and woman of God. You know that already. So I like sharing inside stuff, like the minds of pastors, because I know sometimes you all want to know what we think. Amen. And you know, I go up and down. Sometimes when I go back up, if I say something that I may have to duck, I'm gonna go back up there like that. But I share things. God has to be talking about things that, you know, people sometimes don't really talk about. And in the minds of, you know, because I know you all think this passes at times, you think that we're like, nothing ever bothers us. Amen. I know you just think that, you know, we hang out with Jesus, Gabriel, you know, and we just, you know, and nothing ever bothers us. So let me start off by saying we're human too.
Yes, we are.
Amen. I have a few minutes. I'm just going to talk to you. Because, you know, like, I know they celebrated Jesus too. And, you know, remember his triumphal entry into, Jerusalem, and they was waving, yes! And then a little while later, they were... So I need to talk to you about something for a few minutes that I think is going to encourage you. And it's dealing with your heart.
Amen.
Dealing with your heart. Amen?
Amen.
Because I've been in ministry for a while, Pastor Dave, we've all been in ministry for a while. We've seen a lot of things, and sometimes people, they speak things. This is what I call it. I call it illegal words.
Come on, man.
And he'll say, I'll never leave you. Nor forsake you.
That's what they say.
You all. You're the heir to my wings. I'll do anything for you. And next week, you don't ever see him again. I'm like, Pastor Byrne, remember when so-and-so said, oh, have you seen my eyes?
Illegal words.
So this is what I'm going to talk to you about for a few minutes. And it's going to really encourage you, but most importantly, it's going to help you understand your pastor's
faith.
Amen. Because it's not easy what they do.
Come on. Come on.
Up early, up late.
Come on.
Praying for you. Interceding. You know, I think people do some interesting things. Just say interesting.
Interesting.
Now, the reason why I use the word interesting is because I can't put a word on it. And I gotta stay holy, stay consecrated, so I just say committed, so I wouldn't say something else. You should try that sometimes. Yes. And so, sometimes, you know, in this job assignment that God has given us, sometimes people walk in your life and they walk out.
Amen.
And I've had people walk out without even telling me that they walked.
Right. Great.
Oh my God, dude. I'm giving you the inside stuff today, you know, and sometimes they walk out. Now, you know, that'll happen to your pastors, but you'll never know.
Yeah.
Because they take it to the Lord.
Yeah.
But I'm just here to let you know that it happens sometimes.
Yeah.
And it's not always easy to recover from that because you're asking so many questions like, what's going on here? What happened? Did I do something wrong? Did I say something? Nope, you didn't do anything.
Yeah, right.
It has everything to do with that person's heart.
Right.
So that's what we're talking about. Make room, enlarge your heart. Make room.
Good.
See what Pastor Dave was doing earlier, he was giving you vision and expectation.
Yeah.
Yes. And I know sometimes you hear that, and then you're thinking, oh, why do we have to do that?
Yeah.
That's an indication that your heart is full.
Yeah.
And you need to make room.
Yeah.
So God always gives the vision to the visionary and sees down the road already. He already sees where we're going. And then sometimes we don't want to get on the train.
Come on now. That's right.
Because we want to know who on the caboose.
Yeah. That's good, sir.
And sometimes we question everything. So then, this vision and expectation, exposure enlarges your capacity to believe.
Yeah.
Exposure, like when you see more, you can do more.
Yes. Yes. Wow. That's good.
Yes. So your heart has to be enlarged. So let me start with this. I want to start off by really making sure that if there's anything in our heart, we need to go ahead and clean it out.
Yes.
So I think I have a picture of Psalms 119, wherewithal shall the young man cleanse his way, but by taking heed thereto according to thy word. Thy word have I hid in my heart, that I might not sin against thee, God. That's a little cool little picture. Look at this heart getting the word in. Now notice, it's getting the word in our hearts, not in our heads. Not our heads. Get it in the heart. Please write this down. Your heart, our hearts is the birthplace for all of our increase.
Yes.
If we're going to increase, it has to start in our heart first. That's why we can think of things, have some great ideas, and never see them coming to fruition. You know why? Because it didn't get in your heart.
Good.
Wow.
See? So sometimes we can talk a good game. And what we're talking is from our head.
Yeah. Wow.
But if it never gets to your heart, it will never manifest.
Yeah.
See, let me let you know a secret. Pastor Dave, Pastor Vern, they had you all in their hearts before you came here.
Yes.
They had you in their hearts, all of you, this whole section, before it was even this section.
Jesus.
You were in his heart.
God.
I'm having you see something.
Yeah.
Before there was this section, you were already in his heart.
Yes.
See? And that you being here today is an evidence of manifestation of you already being in your heart.
Yes.
Or else you wouldn't be here.
Yes.
Now, why it took you so long to get here? That's a whole other situation. That's a whole other thing dealing with your heart again.
My God, so good.
The Bible says, who can know the heart?
Yes. Yes.
See, some of you are thinking things in your heart about me right now. Where'd they get him from? Just being honest, I'm you know how they say it, and I never say this, but I feel like I need to say it today. I'll be out your way in a couple minutes. Tell your neighbor, make room. See, I'm just here to encourage you, but also to celebrate your pastor, but also to let you know that it's time to make room. You have to make room in your heart. This is not it, what you see today. It's much more than this. You know what's powerful? Because as your leaders go up, then there you go. So you want to be pushing them up with your heart.
Yes.
Amen?
Yes.
So now, David said this in Psalms 51, give me a clean heart.
Yes.
Verse 10, and renew in me a right spirit.
Yes.
You know, sometimes we could be serving and physically serving. And I call that physical faithfulness, and our hearts not be in it. See, your leaders know when your heart's not in it.
That's right. Yes, they do.
You might not think they know, but they know.
Yes.
So God gives them lots of patience to help you along this journey till you get your heart right.
Yes.
Are you hearing me?
Yes.
See, we're going to take a little heart check in a couple of minutes too. Amen? Because I got to make sure you're all right. Now, it's where everything takes place, In our heart, that's where forgiveness takes place, believing takes place. And in our hearts now, that's what God looks at. The Bible says that man always looks at the outward appearance. That God looks at your heart. Isn't this amazing? Because Sunday morning, we feel like we have to get so dressed up. So we can look up the part. So we can look like we got it going on. But if we really looked inside, what a mess. What a mess. What a mess. See? Because the outward appearance, God is not, he's not concerned as the outward.
Right.
You know what he's concerned about? The heart. Now, Proverbs talks about this. Every issue.
Yes.
You know what the issues are, right? In the heart. So when we say things like, I got an issue with somebody at church.
Come on.
What we're saying is, there's something in my heart. I'm struggling with something in my heart pertaining to that person. So therefore I have an issue. But instead of dealing with it, instead of dealing with the issue, we try to serve around it. Well, if he sits on this side, I'm going to sit on the other side. And all that is an indication that there's an issue in your heart and you can't move forward with God until you deal with that issue. Issue. There's issues. Everything looks fine and daily, but yeah, listen, there's issues. And where do they lie? In our hearts. They lie in our hearts. It's amazing how sometimes we can get offended about things that it's just out of the blue. Sometimes we look for things to get offended about. I mean, we just look, you know, and the Bible says offenses will come, but we have to receive the offense, for the offense can have an effect in our lives. So that means, as mature believers, it doesn't matter what people can say to us. Guess what? It should not affect us because we already know who we are in Christ. And we have to receive that offense. Receive that offense. If you take offense, you know, that's what it says, if you take offense. That means that, okay, something happened, you didn't like it, it created an issue in your heart, and you took that with you. You said, I'm going, let me take that. I don't need to take it, but let me just take it anyway, because I don't understand why he said that. Why he said that. I don't know, why did the pastor say wait on that? I don't understand wait on that. Wait on that. Why he always told me to wait on that? So what happens is we take offense. We take that. And they didn't even say that. But we took it. And we going on with it. Issues. Issues. And we take it. And so if you look at the word offended, if you break it up, it's off-ended. See, the goal of the enemy is to get a believer off-ended. It's to get them disconnected to the family of God, to get them disconnected from the man and woman of God. And it can happen through one issue. Take offense. I'm leaving.
Come on.
Leaving? Why are you leaving? I don't like what they said. What they said? Well, I ain't quite sure, but it sound like that they were sound like they were telling me to wait again. I'm tired of hearing that. I'm ready to go on. I'm ready to do some things, but they keep telling me to wait. I'm going somewhere else that they can use me right away, and I'm still undone. I'm not nowhere ready, but they need me, so I'm gonna go. And they keep telling me to wait.
That's good.
So then now, the man and woman of God have to go before God. They got to take all this stuff before God, just leave it to God. And then they have to come back and deal with you. Tell your neighbor, make room.
Make room.
That's why God speaks to our heart. He never speaks to our head. See, when you're born again, when we're born again, we have to change our minds. That's an ongoing process. It'd be one thing if we get born again and then the rest of us, the rest of our lives and, you know, our body and our minds, wouldn't it be great once we're born again, that gets all together instantly? I don't know where they came up with, you know what, my hands look new, you know, my feet did too, and what is that all about? I mean, once you're born again, you have the same dogs that you had before you were born again. Them chains still size 20. There ain't nothing changed with that. We have to change our mind. And when God puts you in an environment of vision and purpose and faith, then we can't stay the same. We have to make room in our hearts. We have to enlarge our hearts. We have to be willing to get out of our own comfort zone and do something different and do something new and go somewhere we've never gone before. See, you have never been where God is trying to take you. So he'll put people in your life to help you get to where he decides you to be. But what it means, what it requires, I have to relinquish my old ways and how I was brought up. I know when I was brought up in church, we ain't do that. Somebody here, you still holding on to your old ways. Do you know that's long and gone? So the Bible says you can't put new wine in old wineskins. Can I have a few more minutes?
Yeah.
You're preaching fast.
Go ahead. Help us, Jesus.
Now, I wrote this down. The quicker you can detect the wrong heart condition and get it straightened out, the better you can. So this is Proverbs chapter 4, verse 23. It says, guard your heart above all else. For it determines the course of your life. So let's begin to piece everything together. So if I have some wrong thoughts, wrong things in my heart, guess what? I could be going zigzag. Because if my heart now, if guarding my heart is so key to me getting where God desires me to be, then I can't have things in my heart like unforgiveness. I can't have those things in my heart and expect God to take me from point A to point B. No. See, now, if I have the wrong stuff in my heart, and if I'm not guarding my heart, then that's going to cause me to go to places I shouldn't even be and waste my time in places I shouldn't be there. Say, I got to guard my heart. It says, guard your heart above all else, for it determines the course of your life.
Yes.
Notice it doesn't say somebody else should guard your heart. So even though as pastors, God gives us opportunity to watch over people's souls, we can't do anything with your heart. Now watch it over your soul. What is a soul? My mind, my will, my emotion. You know, my chooser, my feeler, my thinker. See, so God gives us responsibility to help you change the way you think. Because the only thing that we can do for you is to help you change the way you think. But your heart, that's you and God.
Yes.
You have a fixed food and your kids don't want to eat?
Yes.
I ain't hungry. You're like, all this food here? What you mean you ain't hungry? Because next day they come in and say, ain't nothing here to eat.
Come on.
You ever hear that? That's another story. Like when kids say there's nothing here to eat, like I have to get their definition of nothing.
Yeah.
Nothing to me means what? Donut. Nothing, right? Zero. But they'll look at the kids, they'll look at the refrigerator, full of food, right? Ain't nothing I want to eat. No, They're like, oh my God, they don't understand what nothing is. Nothing's nothing. If there's some mayonnaise in there, oh hallelujah. If there's a piece of bread in there, oh glory to God. The peanut butter don't even have to be with the chocolate. Say nothing. Nothing is nothing. It doesn't say for somebody else to guard our heart. We have to guard our hearts. So what does that mean? That means being able to detect when the enemy is trying to get you off track. Now, I'm going to take it to another level. Can I do that? Is it okay? If you haven't been offended by your pastors, like, you know, like, if you haven't been in a situation, you're going to be.
Exactly.
It's going to happen. They're going to say something, do something, and it won't even be on purpose or anything. It's not going to be deliberate. Something's going to happen that's going to give you a chance to check your heart. Like if one Sunday they get up and say, can you come on time? How dare he say that to me? How dare he say that to me? I only live 5 minutes away, but the light took so long to change. How dare he say that to me? So now, you can't even hear the word now. You done tuned everything out now. Just here for a few more minutes. But it's serious business though. It's a hard thing. You have to guard your heart. We oftentimes want more from God. Oh Lord, take me to the next dimension. Oh Lord, God's like, hold on. Let's deal with what's in your heart. And sometimes we can have things still in our heart from our childhood that make it difficult for us to receive leadership and instruction. And it started when we were very young. Didn't want to come in the house on time. So now that's still plaguing us today. When we say, I'm going to do great things for God. God's like, hold on, that's still what's in your heart first. Let's look at that. You got to guard it.
Yeah, amen.
You gotta guard it.
Amen.
You gotta guard it. Amen. Listen, let me tell you something. We was a Pastor Bernard in Philadelphia. Oh my Lord. I worked in so many areas of ministry, and I remember the sound ministry.
Yes.
You know. Now, this is how I got part of the sound ministry. We were in the school, we had services at the school, and so Pastor Bernard would get this equipment, and he would he'd call me up and say, you're gonna be come past the school because we had to clean the school and set up. We have a service. So I would come past the school and I would see some mixing board stuff on the table. He'd look at it, he'd say, oh yeah, I'd like to use that tomorrow. And he would just walk out. And I'm thinking, I don't even know what that is. Now, I'm going to help you. You got to enlarge your heart now. Because if your leader, I don't know if you're ready for this, but I got to tell you, if your leaders see something in you, sometimes they see things in you better ask sister so-and-so over there. And see, you don't even know what's brewing in you. This purpose brewing in you. There's anointing on you.
So good.
And it takes a more than man or woman of God to be able to see purpose in you. Especially if you've gone through life and you didn't see your life and it worked anything. So here you come here and now they identify purpose. You're like, no, not me. Yes, you. Because God is not fickle. He's not up there trying to figure out what he's doing. sure if they're my pastors yet. But what are you waiting for it to be on the internet? You want somebody to tweet you? What do you need?
I need a sign.
What? The sign is obedience. You want a sign?
What the Lord told me on Facebook. Let me leave Facebook alone.
People do more talking on Facebook than they do their own family members. Believers. They always got something to say to somebody. And you say, did you talk to so-and-so?
I'm not lately.
You live in the same house. We got a zillion friends on Facebook and then don't communicate with not one person.
I'm up to 2,000 friends. Who do you know?
You have no idea what they sacrifice.
Come on, Nash. Yeah. Come on, Nash.
Yeah. Sometimes things don't already always work out the way you plan, but they still stand in faith.
Yes.
They still stand in the gap. They still get up. They still encourage you. Build you up.
They look like everything's fine with them. Look at them. Look at Pastor Dave. Look at them. Look at Pastor Bernadette. Look at them. They look like nothing wrong with them. They don't need no more help. Let me just
help you. The gift that's in you is not yours. That is not your gift. And we need to stop acting like it's our gift.
That's right. Come on.
And I do this and they do this. Why do we go to work, right? We go apply for this job. We put every single thing we can do in things that we've never done. Why do we put that on the job resume? Why do we do that? I've done this, I've done Excel, I've turned this on, I've worked this computer. The only thing we've done was plug the computer in and turn it on. So on a job interview, we put down anything, you know why? Because we trying to get this job. And you know, ultimately, we trying to get that money. So I'm putting down this. This sounds good. I'll put down this. This sounds good. I've done this for 5 years. How long you really done it? 2 months. Popping it down and that. And then we come to church. We come to church. We're only one. Nobody know nothing. We get in our little huddle sometime. May not be intentional, but we're like, I ain't telling the pastors this. If I can tell them, if I tell them that I've been greeting in other businesses and done greeting workshops and greeting seminars, I ain't telling them this because they ain't trying to have me up there greeting all the time and stuff like that. They ain't trying to be up there greeting all the time. Corporately, but I ain't greeting spiritually. I ain't trying to be at the front door lifting weights off people and giving them, sharing with them the joy of the Lord. I ain't trying to do that because ain't nobody giving me none here at this church. I'm just going to do it corporately. And then the other side of the story, then here it is, that anointed greeter, they'll come in and they'll talk about how bad the greeting is. They really need to have this over by the door. They really need to have that by the door. Listen, let me just politely tell you, you need to can all that. If you're not going to be a help, if you're not going to be a blessing, you know what? Don't even do that. But it's amazing.
Yeah.
All these gifts.
Yeah.
And we think they're ours. When I connected with Pastor Manoah, I realized I started doing things I never thought I could ever do.
Yes.
And it's helped me in my walk with the Lord.
Yeah.
And it all goes back to enlarging my heart.
Yes.
Enlarging my heart. Let me say this one more time. That's not your gift.
That's right.
Woe unto you think that's your gift.
Yeah.
That is not your gift. And I encourage you to submit that gift to God. And wherever they need you, you're doing it as unto the Lord. Colossians 3:22-23 says, all that you do, you do it from your heart. You do it unto the Lord. One way we get offended sometimes is when, if we don't get a pat on the back, if nobody acknowledges us, like, man, I did all that, cooked all that food, nobody said nothing, I ain't cooking another chicken wing. Ain't no problem, we just go to Boston Market. Ain't no big deal.
Are you hearing me?
Because now, you gotta make sure that unforgiveness is not in your heart. You gotta make sure hatred is not in your heart. Because those things will be barriers from enlarging our hearts. Here's what needs to be in your heart. Please write this down. God's purpose and God's plan need to be in your heart.
That's right.
Lord, what's your purpose and your plan for me? You sent me here, Lord. What's your purpose? And what is your plan for me? That has to be in our hearts. Proverbs 19:21 talks about God's plans prevail. Sometimes we have our own little agenda. And we wonder why things are not working out. God's like, I ain't proved that. I improved that. Sometimes we in relationships try to make things work. And God's like, I improve him.
Come on now.
I improve her. Uh-huh. I always tell people when they're in like dating relationships, I'm like, oh, I never met this person. Bring him to the church. That's how I say it. They look at me like, what? Bring him to the church. Bring him. So we can see if this is the real McCoy.
Come on.
I just have some basic questions. Are you born again? Are you hearing me? God's plan and his purpose. You know, God's plan and his purpose. According to Philippians chapter 2, verses 12-13, God wants to work out his good pleasure. So the Bible says, work out your sorrow of salvation with fear and trembling. And then the next verse says, for it is God that worketh his good pleasure in you. So when we come and we become part of the vision of this house, we're giving God some pleasure. When was the last time you really pleased God? Think about it. When was the last time you really pleased him? I mean, pleasing him as you served him.
That's good.
So the Bible says now, we can put ourselves in a profitable position if we make sure our leaders, and Hebrews talks about that, if we make sure our leaders can serve and lead without any struggle, that's how we put ourselves in a profitable position. Oftentimes we say, bless me, Lord, bless me, Lord, bless me, Lord. The Lord said, listen, I want to bless you. But what are you doing to make things easier for my servants? I made up my mind when I was serving with Pastor Bernard, I didn't want him to have to be concerned about anything. You know why? Because God had put the answers to my situations in his mouth.
So if
it's difficult for him to speak because he's so concerned about all the things that's going on, it's like, no way. I don't want anything to hinder God downloading into him. So I would just up my level of serving. Some of you here today, listen, it's time for you to go up to the next level. Some of you have been cruising and you're serving. You've gotten a little bit too comfortable. And see, and that's the trick of the enemy to want us to get to a place where we're just comfortable. No, you see the greatest move of God when you're uncomfortable, because that means you have to rely on him, you have to trust on him, you have to depend on him, you have to stand after you've done all the stands. Some of you are a little bit too comfortable.
Amen.
But he's about to shake it out.
Yes.
He's about to shake it out. Why? Because there's many more people to reach.
Yeah. Glory to God.
There's more people to reach.
Glory to God.
I can tell you right now, Pastor Dave, Pastor Burr, I know they have people in there.
Yeah.
Can't even see all the people they have in their heart. They're in their heart.
Yes, yes, God.
And this is the other thing that really got me, and I'll come down and stretch with this, is that whenever you get an assignment, you get a piece of their heart.
Yes.
You know, when you have a mother has a newborn, you know, they not pass that baby around everybody.
Come on.
They keep that baby close. And as the baby get older, then if it's somebody they can trust, then they say, can you hold Pookie for a little bit?
Yeah.
Other than that, they ain't, no, that's okay, I can do it. They'll do one thing with this hand, they'll hold the baby with the other hand. You know why? You know why they do that? Because they don't trust anybody to that degree. First of all, you have to be able to be trustworthy. Are you worthy of their trust?
That's good. That's real good.
We're not talking about those seniority, I've been here, this. We're not talking about that. The question is, are you worthy of their trust? Because sometimes we want what somebody else has because it looks like glamorous. You listen. You don't know. Please don't do that because you don't know what comes along with that. I can't wait to be a minister. You may want to slow that down a little bit. You may want to slow that. I can't wait to be a minister. And I'm going to get up there and do my pastor burn. I'm going to preach a word. Before you preach a word, you have to live a word. You got to live it first. Because as a minister and as a preacher, as a pastor, you either go through that situation, that word that you're preaching, you need to go before you preach it. Sometimes you're going through it while you're preaching it, and sometimes you're going through it after you preach it. So Thursday night I'm doing this series on the real kind of joy. So I started that like 2 weeks ago. I'm so excited about that. And I get there on Thursday, I'm like, yes, and I'm just teaching. And then Friday comes. And I'm like, what did I say yesterday? I gotta go back and like, now what I said, what'd you say? Right, joy. Yes, real joy is being able to see the end of your situation. And still have a good attitude while I'm going through it. Because I'm not going to be here a long time. I'm just passing through. So the Hebrew says, looking unto Jesus, 12, the author and finisher of my faith, for the joy that was set before him, endure the cross. Okay, what's so exciting about enduring the cross, despising the shame? That means people are going to talk about him, spit on him. I'm like, what joy did he see? He's seen our inheritance.
Yes.
See, let me encourage you today. Real joy is being able to see beyond where you are and see yourself on top and see the word coming to pass and having a good attitude while you're passing through. See, that's why you're on that job. Sometimes when things get interesting, we want to leave the job. I'm tired of these people in this job. All of them, but he's... And that's right where God put you to develop you. That's right where he put you. He prepared ministry when I used to work in Northeast Philadelphia, and I would work with these guys at work, man, they were like anti-God. You know, it was just, you know, I mean, just all kind of stuff. And then the Lord would challenge me about my serving. Now watch this. I was serving at church, but he was challenging me about my serving at work.
Come on now.
So I was praying for an increase, and God would open doors. He said, go ask the John Supervisor. He said, go ask John, he needs some help. I'm like, ask him, huh? Now I'm a born again believer, right? Love God. I was like, nope. And the Lord said, you want what now? I said, I want an increase, God. You know what's really in my heart. He said, I'm waiting on you. So then when I started asking John, you need any help? So I started helping with this. And then what happened was, God, this situation came up where I was due for a raise, and John didn't want to sign for it. So the Lord allowed his boss to see what I was doing and came to me and said, aren't you up for a raise? I'm like, yeah. And he said, well, why didn't it come through? I said, I guess he didn't put it through. He said, don't worry about it, I'll take care of it. So after that happened, I knew God was watching. So then he told me, okay, if I can do that, then I can do what's really in your heart. The Lord told me this.
Yes.
And sure enough, God opened the door.
Yes.
Because we live life from the inside out.
Yes.
Are you hearing me? You buy everything twice, you know? You buy it with your heart first, and then you buy it with your money. If you go see those shoes, and those shoes are $20 over what's in your heart that you want to pay, you'll say, oh, no, thank you. You'll go two doors down, right? And see those same shoes for $20 left. You're like, oh, yes, that's where I'm going to be. You know, the reason why you left the first store is because you couldn't cover what they had in your heart first. Are you hearing me? So we go down to that other store that must lesser price that we can cover it in our heart. You do everything twice. That's why it's such a struggle. It can be a struggle to give sometimes. You know why? Because we haven't covered it in our heart. That's a heart issue.
Wonderful.
Serving, giving, unforgiveness, it's all heart. It's all heart. That's what it is. It has nothing to do with the leaders. It has nothing to do with God. It's a heart. Whenever we have trouble, give.
Wonderful.
Whenever we struggle with that, what that means is there's something that God has said to you that you're not fully convinced of. That's what it is. It's something that God has spoken that you're not fully convinced. That's why Abraham, God gave him that promise. The Bible says in Romans 4, he was fully persuaded. Giving glory and honor to God. See, when you get to that point of being fully persuaded, you will see the goodness of God like you've never seen before. But you know what it is? Enlarging our hearts. Enlarging our hearts. Let me read something to you. Let me see if I can find this here. He's like, he didn't even read any scriptures. I've been saying it. I've been saying them. They're in my notes. But I'm trying to get to everything where God, you know, because I know it's not about me. I'm just staying sensitive to God, you know, because I, you know, because sometimes people say I got this book, I'm gonna preach, and I ain't gonna preach nothing else. But you know, I just learned I gotta stay open to God. I'm not here for me. It's not about me. So God is just dropping, okay, touch on this, touch on that. You know, I don't know where you are. I have no idea. I'm not sure where you are at this point in your life. But I know you're here this morning for a reason.
Amen.
You're here this morning.
Hallelujah.
And I encourage you, if you get that thing right in your heart this morning, you get that, if you just go ahead and take care of that this morning, God will open doors in a way that you've never seen before. No one's trying to hold you back. Nobody. Nobody can hold you back but you. Nobody can hold you back. So God says now, this word needs to be in our heart. So his purpose, his plan, the word, and God says, this word and this faith has to be in your heart. Has to be in your heart. Look what it says in Mark 11. Mark 11 says this is so powerful. Starting at verse number 22, Mark 11, 22. It says, have faith in God. Jesus answered, truly, I tell you, if anyone says to this mountain, go and throw yourself into the sea and does not doubt in their heart, but believes that what they say will happen, it will be what? Done for them. So I'm reading in the New International Version. It says it will be done for them. It'll be done. And then it says, therefore I tell you, whatever you ask for in prayer, believe that you've received it, look at this, and it will be what? it will be yours.
Yes, yes.
And it says, and when you stand praying, if you hold anything against anyone, forgive them. So that your Father in heaven may forgive you your sins. Now, Mark 11, 22, 23, and 24 is so powerful. Because it's talking about, you know, having what you say. Having what you say. But let me tell you something. That mountain won't move if you got unforgiveness in your heart. So we can say, thank you, Pastor. Thank you, Pastor Dave, for that scripture. Thank you. Oh, I got it. I'm just going to speak to the mountain and tell it to move. Mountain, move! And then the Lord says, read verse 25. If you really want the mountain to move, forgive somebody. Let somebody out of prison. Release that person. If we really want that, because if unforgiveness gets in our heart, it's going to stop us from enlarging and expanding. Expanding. I remember a number of years ago when we were believing God for our home, and I was like, I don't know how God's going to do it, but I know He's going to do it. And He was telling me, you got to enlarge your heart, you got to see more. So I used to leave the church and drive down 896 and to go to our home, and I would pull up in front of the house, and no one was there, and I would just cover the house in my heart. Like I started counting the windows. I was like, oh man, that's a lot of windows. I've never had that many windows. I had to get all the windows in my heart. Then I had to get the additional rooms in my heart. This is a whole process. I had to cover it in my heart first. I remember one time my wife and I was having this conversation. We were talking about getting our hair done. I'll never forget this conversation. And I never brought it up again. So bear with me as I tiptoe to this. So we were talking about getting her hair done. So I grew up in a big family, so my sisters, they used to just do their own hair. So I said, men, fellas, please just learn from me. Don't say this. So I said, well, can't you do your own hair? And she turned around and looked. And I'm like, beam me up, Jesus. Get me out of here. And she's like, no, I would like to go to the hairdresser to get my hair done, you know, on a regular basis. At that moment, I realized I had covered my wife being married, but I had never covered the things that were connected to her. And the Lord showed me, He said, you never covered her hair appointment.
Wow. Excellent.
That's good. I'm going to leave that alone. Because I know some ladies on the way home, they're going to be on the way home like, honey. You heard what Pastor Ray was saying. You might as well go ahead and cover those shoes on the way home. And I realized I had never covered that. So I had to make room in my heart. But here upon it. And we've never had an issue. Notice I said issue. With that, ever since I've seen that, I had never covered that.
So good. Awesome, awesome, awesome.
Yes, we're asking God for more, but can we cover it? Yes, we ask the Lord for this special person to come into our lives, but can we cover them? We have to enlarge our heart. I had slides. I didn't show any of those slides. I don't know. I have something with seeds back there, right? Don't I have seeds? Seeds. I don't know where I am. I'm almost done. I'll be out of your way in a second. Look at all those seeds in that heart.
Wow.
God God has tremendous things for you.
Yes.
Those seeds. Let me move right along and finish up here. I hope this is encouraging.
Yes.
This takes us to that. I'm going to continue with Faith Your Heart. I'll come down and shut with that. But it's also important to have excellence in your heart. It's a series of adjustments when you're connected to a man or woman of God who is all about excellence.
Amen. Amen.
It's a culture change.
Yes.
One day Pastor Bernard came in and we were at the Germantown church. And he would come in and he always surveyed everything. You know, he's like, yeah. And then he called me one day. He's like, Pastor Bernard. I was like, yeah. And I was like, yes, sir. He said, there's a wire that's hanging over there. He's like, yeah, right there by the minor speaker. And at that day, I learned the attention to detail.
Yes.
Excellence is the attention to detail bringing about a superior performance. Sometimes it takes the church, sometimes we just want to throw anything together.
You better get on.
Excellence. If it's not in your heart, it'll never be in your life. Are you hearing me? Because excellence will make you fix the hinges on your door, on your front door. Excellence, I'm telling you, excellence will have you call a contractor to fix that. Instead of catching it every time you go home, catching the door. We say the Lord know. The Lord know that excellence is not really in our hearts.
Wow. Bless God.
Can I just do just a little bit more? Oh, I got to do it. I have a countdown clock at my church. And they like start it and it starts counting down. And if somebody's come and talks, so I'm like, yo, you on my tongue. You on my tongue. People in your heart. People in your heart. So that means we have to stop saying, I can't stand people.
Wow.
I don't do people. Oh no, God, not people. Now think about that. Think about how that sounds. I don't do people. I ain't going to the women's ministry because I don't do people. I don't know what they talk about. I ain't even trying to get up in all that stuff, get up in all that. I don't do people. Come on out to the women's ministry. I don't do people. Bunch of women getting together. I don't do people. As soon as we get to work. And somebody say, hey, let's go down to... Count me in. Count me in. You don't even have to ask me twice. Count me in. I'll be there. Right after work, no problem. It's a little inconvenience, but I'll be there. It's costing me money I don't have, but that's okay because you asked me, I'm going to be there. Somebody haven't been to the women's ministry yet. It's here today. Somebody haven't been. God's saying, what you waiting for? See, God has put things in the woman of in the woman of God that's going to help you. What it is, you're kind of afraid of that. I ain't getting too close to her, but she might see something. Baby girl, come on over here. Nah, I ain't trying to do that. She might see something. Remember the story of Zacchaeus.
Yes.
In Luke 19. And Jesus was just passing through. And Zacchaeus was a little short. Yes. Jesus! Yes. And he's like, man, come on, stop all that. Jesus! Then he went and jumped up in a sycamore tree. Because he was short in stature.
Yes.
And because Jesus had people in his heart,
yes,
he stops just somebody's calling.
Yes. 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 So good.
He says, Zacchaeus, I ain't trying to dig in your past.
Yes. Yes.
Now come on. Come on down.
Yes.
Come on. Go to Starbucks with me.
Yes.
Come on. Go to Chick-fil-A with me. Come on. Come on. Let's have lunch at my house.
Yes.
Why do we have to size people up all the time? Let me see what he all about.
Come on,
Jesus. You've been here twice.
Wonderful, Jesus.
Let's see what they are. Now we forget that our leaders are laying before God,
yes,
praying for souls and people. Listen, everybody needs Jesus, whether the CEO, the vice president, the supervisor, the managers, the maintenance people. Everybody needs Jesus. It doesn't matter what their occupation or what their job is, because they're not going to stand before God and say, well, because our president couldn't let me in. No, where is the blood-stained banner of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ? So listen, people are people. And when you have people in your heart, that means you have God's purpose, God's plan, God's desire in your heart. Because Jesus, the only reason why he came is for people. He didn't come to make a name for himself. He didn't come to build his own thing yet. No, he came to seek and save those that were lost. And so as believers, as mature believers, when we really get that in our heart, that it's all about people, we'll begin to lay aside our gender. We'll begin to lay aside things that don't really mean much to us. And we'll get God's heart, God's mind. And in God's heart and mind is people.
Yes.
It's all about people. So let's make this the last day that we say, I don't do people. Because if you're going to do God, you can't do God without people.
That's right.
Are you hearing me? Are you hearing me? This is the last thing I'm going to tell you, and I'm going to be done. I am done. Amen?
Amen.
When that word comes, we have God's plan, God's purpose, got the word in our hearts, got faith in our heart, got people in our heart. When that word comes, there's four types of ground. You got to get this, because this opened my eyes. Matthew chapter 13 talks about this. In fact, I'm just going to be the last thing I'm going to be, and then we'll tie things together with it. I'm okay. Nah, I just want to make sure I heard. I'm okay. That's fine. They do all kinds of stuff about you. They, like at the time of them, they like pull out stop signs and stuff like that. Like, on those street. And then I humbly submit. Alright, let's see what we're being here. Well, it's the story of the parables. I'm gonna make sure I have the right one. I'm in the right place. I just want to make sure I'm reading the right verse. Okay, here we go. Great. Verse 18, please. Verse 18. Because it talks about that in different parts of the chapter, but I want to jump right into 18. Are you with me?
Yeah.
Remember the time we used to hear pages turning?
Right.
It's like, look, the pages turning. But now we're, you know, sometimes we have every app in the phone except the Bible. Anyway, verse 18. Listen then to what the parable of the sower means. When anyone hears the message about the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what was sown in their what? Now this is powerful. And this is going to help you understand even in a greater way the two sowers that you have. Listen, every time God uses them to share, they're not just bumping their chops or just wasting time. They're sowing. The sower sows the word. And this is what it says. It says now, the evil one comes and snatches away what was sown in their heart. Notice, it says now, when we don't understand it, that's when the enemy can snatch it. It doesn't matter how good that word was. If we don't take time to get understanding of it, then the enemy can come and what? Snatch it away. Snatch it away. So watch this now. It says there, the evil one comes to snatch away the word was sown in their heart. This is the seed sown along the path, right? The seed falling on rocky ground refers to someone, look at this, who hears the word and at once receives it with what?
Joy.
With joy. Oh my God, didn't he preach today? Oh, yeah, praise the Lord. I'm going to stand up on that. Go ahead. Then it says, but when they have no root, they last only at what? Short time. Now this is what I was talking to the Lord about this, because you know how sometimes you would see a person, you don't see them.
Yeah.
You see this individual, and you, when you first seen them, when they started coming, they were so, and you're like, wow. And then the Lord, you're like, where is so-and-so? They just come in, you're like, where is so-and-so? What happened to so-and-so? And the Lord took me to Matthew 13, he said, son, he said, when that happens, it's connected to this.
Yeah.
What? He said they were hearing it, but they weren't good understanding. And then they were hearing it, they was excited about it, but they never got down. Never got down. Then it says this. This is seed sown on the path. The seed falling on rocky ground refers to someone who hears the word and at once receives it with joy. But since they have no root, they only last for a short time. Look at this. It says, when trouble or what? Or persecution comes, because of the word, they quickly what? Fall away. So let me encourage you. I'm coming down a stretch. Your heart now is the birthplace for all of your increase. So every time the word is sown into your heart now, it does matter what type of ground your heart is at that moment that the word is being sown. Because if it's stony, if it's rocky ground, we'll get excited about it. And if it doesn't take root, it's only a matter of time that we're going to fall away. Now notice what it says. It says now, the seed falling among the thorns refers to someone who hears the word. Matter of fact, let me go back up to verse 21. But have no root, they only last a short time when trouble or persecution. So we can pick our choice. We can call it trouble or we can call it persecution.
Yeah.
Whenever you hear the word, trouble or persecution is coming.
Know that.
And it's not coming for you. It's coming for what?
For the word.
Do you see this? It's not coming for you. It's coming for the word in you. So every time you hear the word taught and preached and shared, it's like, well, let me get this. First of all, let me get it in my heart. Let me get some understanding. So I may have to go get the CD. Let me go get the CD. Let me make that investment. Get the CD. Let me play it again. Because, that lesson was powerful. Pastor Dave shared that. Pastor Bird that shared that. And you know what? I only got a little bit of it. I need to work on this. Let me go get the CD. Play it back Monday. Play it back Tuesday. I got it. Wednesday, I got it. Yes. Okay, great. Let me get ready for Bible study. Let me get the message from that. Let me start working. See, we don't work on it long enough. Play it back. So you can now begin to speak it. So now you can begin to live that according to that word. That's when the light bulb comes on. And guess what? Whatever you understand, you can repeat it at will.
Yes.
Amen. Whatever you understand, no one could take that from you. That's why I starts off by saying, you got to get some understanding. Now watch this. This is so powerful. The seed falling among the thorns refers to someone, look at this, who hears the word, watch this, but the worries of this life and the deceitfulness of wealth do what?
Choke.
Choke. We're just choking it out of you. So by the time we leave the church, we're so excited. We get home, something happens Monday, Tuesday, something happens on the job, and it starts. And we're thinking like, what is going on, man? Things are crazy. What is going on? And we fail to realize that here it comes now, trying to choke out the word. The last thing the enemy wants in our lives is that we're fruitful.
Amen.
He don't mind you coming to church.
Amen.
Just don't get an understanding.
Amen.
You can come as often as you want. Stay all day if you want.
That's right.
Long as you don't understand it.
Yes.
Long as you don't get an understanding.
Yes.
Finishing with this. But the worries of this life and the deceitfulness of wealth choke the word. Here's that next part. Make it what? Wait a minute. You mean to tell me that when I first heard the word and I got understanding, I started getting it in my heart, the word itself was already designed to bring about fruitfulness in my life? But if I focus on what's going on, if I start worrying about things, if I start saying my money is funny and I'm trying to get this to get some more money over here, and I know it's not lining up with God, but I'm going to do it anyway because I need some money, at that moment I begin to do that, it now stops this word from being fruitful in my life. So when I start worrying about things, now the word says, hold on, don't worry about it because I can't do nothing now. I can't bring it to pass now. I can't bring about fruit in your life. It says when I start worrying, when I get to the point where I'm so consumed about everything that's going on around me, I stop the word from being fruitful in my life. And so it says, making it unfruitful.
Yeah.
The Lord showed me that. I'm like, what? I didn't realize I was doing that, Lord. The Lord told me, he said, son, every time you worry, you go to that deep inner word. He said, you stop me.
Yes.
I don't care how many scriptures you got on the wall. How many you got on the 3x5 card. It doesn't matter. But if I get over there and I'm worrying and the cares of this world, that's why he tells us to cast our cares upon him. Because he cares for us. If I have all that in my heart, it makes this unfruitful. Okay, coming down to stress, tying things together. So that means every time the sower sows the word, then that means God is trying to set me up to bring about fruit in my life. Every time the sowers sow the word. Oh, we're not just coming to have church around here. I'm coming to church so I can become fruitful in everything that God said that belongs to me. So he raises up a man and woman of God so they can sow this word there. Go before God. Get that wisdom and sow it in my life. Why? For the sole purpose of me being fruitful. Much better than you do right now. You just gotta learn how to get this word and get that thing in your heart now and get some understanding. It's designed to bring about fruitfulness.
Yes.
Isn't it amazing that a weed can come up anywhere? It should be called the unstoppable weed. Because it comes up in your garden and everything. Then it comes through cement. I'm like, who in the world will sow the weed seed in the cement? Who in their right mind would do that?
Wow, my God.
But see, it's getting understanding. So we look at coming to church differently. We're not coming to have church. I'm coming to become more fruitful. And the pastor sharing this word,
right.
Oh yeah, I'm going to be right there. Yeah. And watch this. Here's the last ground, the good ground.
Yeah.
See, when the word is sown on good ground, and I'm getting some understanding, and even though things are happening in my life, I'm not putting my focus on that.
Right.
I'm keeping my eyes on God.
Right.
And so every time I hear it now, I know some difficult things are going on in my life right now, but you really want things to happen, your heart has to be good ground now. If you really want to increase, then your heart has to be good ground now. So every time that word is sown, it's sown on the good ground of my heart. So the Bible says now, you can expect to have increase, some 30, some 60, some 100 more. That all depends on how you get the word in your heart. If you take time to get understanding of that word, you'll never be the same. Sometimes God will say, give this, and your mind will say, you crazy. But your heart has said, no, God's got me. God's faithful. See, your heart will say, bless the man and woman of God, and your mind will be like, they people just like me. Don't let that get you. They're your holy hookups. Every believer be your holy hookups. Are you here? Thank you so much for your time. I want to pray. As they connect, would it be okay if I pray? You all get prayer? Please bow your heads. I just always count it a privilege and an honor to be here. I never take this like, never, ever. So if you're here today, if you don't know the Lord, and I would assume everyone knows the Lord, you have accepted Christ into your heart by faith, and you would like to do that, would you slip up your hand at this time? Just put it up. Put it down. So just raise it high so I can see it. If you'd like to give your heart to the Lord, just raise it high so I can see it. Once you raise it, you just put